Hi guys, I'm Eddie Ramos, and welcome to The Modern Actor, the show where I take a glimpse into the journeys of rising artists. Today I'm talking to actor Alex Alcheh. I don't think anyone out there listening to this knows this, but Alex was one of the big reasons why I decided to create The Modern Actor. I don't even think you know that, yeah.
Wow.
The Modern Actor came about from this project that Alex, he directed, co-produced, co-created the first SU alumni, so Syracuse University Alumni Showcase, half live, half film scenes. And I was able to be an actor in one of the scenes for the showcase, and watching Alex do his thing, kind of like a fly on the wall. I mean, it was an elaborate project. To me, it seemed like the most daunting thing in the world. He also had help from another friend of ours from Syracuse also, but it really inspired me, and I had to ask him about the whole process, and I knew I needed to pick his brain, but I couldn't just pick up the phone or take the guy out for a drink. I had to set up this elaborate three-camera setup just to ask him how that went down and talk to him. So, you know, this is definitely for you guys listening out there, but for the most part, it's my own selfish thing. It's for my benefit because
this
I am
is for
just...
us.
Yeah, this is just for us. Yeah. I'm super curious to know how it all went down, you know what I mean? Everything from directing that and sort of your journey from where you started to where we are now. So without further ado, guys, Alex Alcheh.
Woo.
Woo.
Let's do it.
And I will probably go back and forth calling him Alex and Alcheh. He goes by many, many names.
Many a nickname.
Alcheh is his last name. Goes by the cheese meister. So if I break in and out of that, you just bear with me, guys. Mm-hmm. All right. So I want to start this interview by asking you a question that I ask all my guests.
Yeah, man.
When did you start acting? And what made you decide to pursue it as a career?
Yeah, I actually got into it later than a lot of, I mean, I started at 14, I did my first musical in high school, but I would like watch my cousin act when I was younger, and she was always like, you're gonna do this, you're gonna do this, and I was always like, I am? And then I did, and that freshman year of high school, I had like a ridiculous chorus part, just, I have an absurdly high falsetto, I don't know if you know that.
I do.
And so I had like just one like we won't have to talk, and that was it. And I
you
was
knew
like,
you were Hollywood.
And I was like, this is amazing. But then I started dating this girl in high school who luckily had been acting forever, and she sort of introduced me to an acting teacher. And really, without her, like she kind of gave me the real bug of like this is like I believe in you.
Yeah,
you're capable of more than just that one falsetto thing. So. Yeah, I started taking acting classes with this woman, Flo, in this like 95-year-old woman, Flo. And I was like, I gotta do this. I have to. This is the most amazing thing in the world. And
so that was in high school. And then senior year, you decided, like, you told your parents, like, listen, I'm gonna go to acting school and like and get a BFA and all that?
Yeah, at the end of junior year was when I was like, I want to do this.
Right.
And my mom was like, are you sure you don't want to just be a lawyer and then act in community theater? And I was like, no, absolutely not. And then I auditioned for a bunch of schools and chose Syracuse.
Yeah.
And it's kind of been the flow ever since.
Nice. And then so you, I know you were in New York for a while, right?
Like, yeah.
You graduated Syracuse when? I'm going to age you a little bit, but when did you graduate Cuse?
2011.
2011. No, you're fine.
Not that long, yeah.
2011, you graduated, and then, so how much time
I was there for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
I was there for 3 years, three and a half around, and struggling, man. I mean, New York really kicked my ass. Am I allowed to curse?
Yeah, oh yeah. It's explicit.
Fucking kicked my ass. No.
It's safe for kids, yeah.
It really kicked my ass. When you get out of school, the first thing you want to do is you're like, yeah, this is going to be great. And there was a showcase in for seniors then, and I was in the showcase, and I thought I was just gonna hit the ground running. I thought my scenes were killer. I had casting directors and agents coming up to me being like, you were so great, oh my God, fantastic. And I was like, this is gonna be the easiest thing ever. Acting's easy, this career's a joke. Not a single meeting from that showcase.
Yeah.
And then I kind of had to start from square one while watching like friends succeed very early, while watching, you know, friends be on Broadway and 6 months out of school, and it was tough.
Yeah.
And that kind of got the best of me rather than using my creativity to do what I now do.
Right.
So New York was kind of the trials and tribulations of everything, and then the kicker was also my apartment went on fire.
What?
And yeah, it burned down like 6 months before moving here, but all my stuff was fine. I'm fine. Everyone was fine. Everyone's safe. But then I didn't have to pay rent for like 6 months, and so I was able to save up enough money.
Wow.
And came out and now I'm here.
So that is how you save for a trip to LA.
Yeah, like, yeah. Just burn down your house.
Your house is on fire. Yeah, exactly. We're not
and
telling
don't pay
you
rent.
To do that. Yeah, exactly. Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah.
So, all right, really quickly, if you could give me, so then you came to LA after the 6 months of free rent. So now we're in what, like 2013? Did you come out here?
2014.
Sorry, 2014. So let's talk about just some of the major differences, like three differences between working in New York and now what you feel in LA.
Yeah. So, New York's a theater town predominantly. I mean, it's definitely grown exponentially in terms of TV and film, but I didn't know how to get in TV and film there. But I think theater wise, like everyone is going to EPAs, everyone is doing this. And I honestly think like, let's be real, there's better actors in New York. Overall, everyone is a trained actor in New York, and not everyone is an actor in New York.
Right.
So the pool is smaller, and I think a little more cutthroat.
Yeah, good, yeah, right.
And I think in LA, everyone's an actor.
Sure.
So it's harder to get in rooms, but if you have training, if you're talented, it's gonna win out eventually.
Easier to stand out.
Exactly.
The crowd,
whereas, like, if you're good in New York,
oh yeah,
it's still get tough because everyone's good in New York.
Gotcha. And then, do you want to talk a little bit about just kind of the daily grind of a day in New York as opposed to LA?
What
do you think?
I mean, whew, the daily grind. I mean, whether it's winter or summer in New York, it's either freezing or 9,000 degrees.
Right.
And I mean, rent in New York is just difficult. The quality of life is just tough.
Yeah.
And I miss New York. I'm a New Yorker. I miss New York so much.
Yeah.
But I don't think, I think it's easier to struggle in LA than it is to struggle in New York.
Gotcha.
It's just brutal. And I worked two restaurant jobs during that time and still struggling to pay rent.
Right. I mean, I was talking to a New York actor, Dario, our friend of ours.
Yeah.
And he kind of said like the weather and the, like the train and all that adds to his grind. I mean, Dario's from Irvine, California, so maybe he enjoyed this, what we didn't enjoy all his life growing up, so he needed that kick or something.
Yeah.
But did you feel that that's what it is as opposed to just being in your car in LA?
Yeah,
or
I mean,
like,
it's a double-edged sword, I think. I think, you know, the energy of New York is so intoxicating and can either propel you or really deter you from doing what you need to do. And I think for me, it really sort of hurt me more than helped because I was watching everyone like going to work and doing their thing and people running to auditions and doing this and doing that. And if I didn't have an audition that day, you really saw it and felt it more than like, I'm on a mountain or I'm at the beach or I'm in a bad mood. Right. So I'm going to go like for a long drive to Santa Barbara because you can do that here.
LA definitely offers that escape from the industry, even though it's all around us. This is Hollywood. I mean, no matter where, what corner you turn on, you're seeing somebody do filming or some ads or whatever, a friend on a billboard. But I agree.
But you can very much choose to engage or not. Whereas in New York, you either are stuck in
the energy.
You're either in your apartment or you are around everybody.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. All right. So let's fast forward. So you come to LA 2014 and within a year, and that was also one of the reasons why I was so impressed and taken aback by what you did, because within a year you decided to take on this mega project.
I had this idea. I came here and I did like a really, I paid like $1,000 to do a showcase in front of like 10 agents and 10 casting directors, and that's how I got my first manager and commercial agent, and it wasn't really working out great for me, and I was like, fuck, I really thought that I like figured it out. I thought that, being in a new place and having these new people were gonna help, and it didn't, because it wasn't the right people for me.
Right.
So I wanted to showcase the real parts of people, the real me, because most showcases are just like stock scenes or overdone scenes.
Right.
And so I had this idea for a all original material, all Syracuse alumni showcase, half live and half filmed. So I was like, all right, how the hell do I do this? And
Sorry to cut you off, but was there a moment that, like, when was the inception of that idea? Like, were you, I mean, it was after your showcase, but after that, like, after spending the $1,000, were you just like, I'm not feeling,
you know,
like...
I think I had the idea when I was in New York.
Oh, okay, wow.
And I was just kind of afraid to do it there.
Yeah.
I was afraid to really bring anything to fruition there for some reason. Mm-hmm. Other than fear, I really can't explain as to why. And then I came here and I was like, new day, fresh start. I'm going to bring my ideas to life. And my girlfriend at the time was like, do it.
Yeah.
You have to do it.
Yeah.
And then I kind of put out a message on Facebook because I had no idea how well. Actually, the first thing I did, was I sent an email to Ralph Zito, who's the head of the Syracuse University Drama Department. I was like, hey, I have this idea. He's like, it's an amazing idea. Why don't you write a proposal to the dean and see if we can help fund it? Because I knew that if I didn't have, like, produced in association with Syracuse University on it, it wasn't going to be as legit.
Gotcha.
So that all worked out. They luckily funded half of the showcase. And then... I had auditions and required every actor who was in it to raise $200 each, which was pretty easy.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, now how do I put all this together?
Yeah.
How do I get these live scenes? How do I get the writers involved? So I kind of put out a Facebook message to one of the Syracuse groups and was like, hey, anybody who wants to be a writer on the showcase? And Marianne, who was my co-producer on it, sent me a message. It was like, I want to help you do this.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm going to need all the help I can get.
Right.
Great. And it was like such a weird marriage because we just like butt heads, but we also really mesh so well together. I could not have done it without her.
One of the things I was impressed with also just being on set was like the fluidity between you guys, like whether she was like taking kind of the helm for a second and you were kind of taking me to the side or whatever. Like,
yeah,
the machine was working. I mean, what I witnessed from my own scene, like it was, the writing was there, the directing, Marianne's hand and everything. Like, again, like we do so many projects where, you know, something's kind of not there,
sure.
you know what I mean? But like, I feel like all the parts were in place for this project, and
well, I appreciate it. I mean, we spent like 3 months developing the scenes with you guys and bringing the writers in and saying, this is how we want to showcase you, what do you think?
Right.
And then sort of like, what about this character, what about if this situation was the case? And then the writers would go and we would develop the scenes that way. And because we rehearsed so much, kind of like a play, we shot, which I'll never do again, we shot 28 pages in a day, which was insane. And like we were behind too, and the first scene was behind and then we sort of caught up throughout the day, but it was like the most insane day of my life. I was bleeding at one point. I was like all over the place, just doing crazy
shit. If you don't shed blood for your project, you're not doing it right.
You're not doing it right.
Get me a knife really quick.
That's what I say.
But you know what? I didn't notice that. I mean, maybe it was because you were behind the camera for my scene. Obviously, I was working.
Yeah.
I was working with Marianne in our scene.
Right.
But I felt that you were cool, calm, and collected. And it made me think, like, and I couldn't remember off the top of my head, but had you directed anything before?
It's interesting because I had never really directed for camera before. Mm-hmm. I had done a bunch of theater stuff in college and then a little bit post. And I just always kind of wanted to and sort of understood it. I don't really know how or why. I mean, it's just, I was always very analytical, so I always knew how to direct actors, and then like kind of directing for the camera was something I was gonna sort of just learn.
Right.
And you know, luckily we had a great DP and he was super helpful, and every scene kind of had a different feel and take to it, which is really cool. And it was very guerrilla, so we were able to be like, this isn't working, let's change. Remember, I mean, we found that, we found a shot in your scene that was like probably my favorite shot in the whole thing, and we wouldn't have been able to do that. We were like, all right, it's just gonna be a multicam kind of setup.
Right.
We really tried to make it our own. I think we accomplished that.
Absolutely. And did you have like a certain approach in your head stylistically that you were going for the look? I mean, I know you're talking about like these raw emotions and you talked about the guerrilla style. Were there any like influences from other directors that you were kind of watching?
Yeah, I mean, so for certain scenes were a little more, I had like a romantic sort of breakup, and then I had sort of a romantic comedy, and then I had sort of a sister bonding, and then I had your scene, which was kind of like a fighter fighting to get out of his like get out of the element people are trying to put him into.
Sure, right.
So yours, I wanted to be very handheld, which was, it's kind of remind a little bit like a Fight Club kind of
right.
vibe to it. Really tight shots. And then other scenes, I really wanted to let it breathe and like my friends Chelsea and our friends Chelsea and Tony had mm-hmm. a scene where it was like a very soft, genuine breakup. So it would start slow. Like Mark Duplass kind of starts like from the outside and
gotcha.
Slowly you'll find that his scenes will work its way in
right.
as it gets to its climax. And
right.
that's kind of where we
oh, that's awesome.
Kind of built. And so that's, you know, I kind of like steal from everyone. Like Scorsese says, like
yeah.
artists steal.
That's right.
I've read like a couple books. I've sure. You know, I've watched a billion movies
sure.
and kind of just have learned by doing.
Right.
And I'm going to keep making mistakes and I'm going to keep fucking up. But I don't think, like I never wanted to go to film school. I kind of just wanted to do it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where I'm at. And then, yeah, that was kind of the showcase. And then it was all, then we geared up again and then wrote all the live scenes. And then I directed all the live scenes and then we put it all together.
Wow. And then, so to make things even harder for yourself, you also acted in two of the things. So you acted in the live scene and you acted on film too.
Yeah.
I am so curious, and I guess, it took me this long to ask you how that happened.
Yeah.
But how does that go about? I'm curious, like, you know, when you're directing yourself on film, is it a constant bounce back between you and the camera? Is that when your AD steps in?
Well, what was so crazy about this, and I can probably speak more to it in, mm-hmm. in the short I directed, mm-hmm. which was way more, because I was in it too the whole
oh,
time
wow.
and directed it. And wrote it.
This is a recent short.
This is a very recent short.
Cool.
So we'll talk about that. But
okay.
with this, like I said, we shot 28 pages in a day after directing all these scenes. I was like, you know what? Let me act in this really hard scene.
I'm ready now. Yeah.
I'm ready. It was
yeah.
crazy. And plus, to top it all off, we only had, I believe, like 8 minutes left on the card.
Mm-hmm.
So we had one take each.
Right.
Of like our coverage, we had very specifically like, all right, this is going to be this, this is going to be that, this is going to be this, and that's all the time we have,
right.
or we're going to have to find some way to do it. And we got it all in one take. And, you know, and Marianne was so lucky to have her. She is a really smart actress
mm-hmm.
and smart writer and director in her own right, that she was able to be like, I got you.
Yeah.
Let's just set up the shot and I'll let you know if it's shit. I promise I won't lie to you just
right.
to get it done. And that scene, like, somehow, I mean, Sal's a great actress
yeah.
who I acted with. She got, that was like the scene for her.
Wow.
A manager and an agent and
wow.
a commercial agent all loved her
wow.
from this scene. This one scene with one take all around. It was just really, really lucky. And because, like I said, we rehearsed
yeah.
for so long that, like, if we were off book for months, just kind of tweaking and toying and,
right.
and changing words and doing with this, so the characters were ingrained in us. So kind of like, you know, like in Blue Valentine,
sure.
like they rehearsed for like 2 months and they were so, it was like a play.
Right.
And that's kind of how my approach was with this. It was like, it's the only way we're going to get this done well. The
right.
actors, there not a single cut was because of an actor. Not a single mistake was because of an actor, because they were so ready.
Wow.
And we were really ready, and being in front of the camera while also wanting to be behind the camera, I was ready,
yeah.
which was terrifying and amazing.
But it sounds like, you know, that pressure to get that scene done in 8 minutes and be the director, like,
yeah.
it elevated your performance, you know what I mean? I'm
sure
there's something going on in your head where you're like, you know, I'm helming this thing, like, I'm not trying to waste anyone's time
right.
either.
I gotta
you
step
know what
up.
I mean? Right, right.
I gotta step up.
Right. And
you knew
you
luckily
had.
I did.
Yeah, exactly. But I wanted to ask you, now that you've worked as a director, how do you think that affects your work when you're an actor on set? Because you just did Dear White People,
yeah,
which is awesome,
yeah.
you know? And
it's interesting because you kind of see how different directors, I just did Dear White People, which is a sort of very collaborative process, which is kind of strange for TV. And then I did Nancy Meyers' movie, The Home Again, the Reese Witherspoon movie.
Nice.
Where it's like, this is how you do it.
Right.
You are not an actor, you are a puppet.
Right.
And I was like, oh God, I hope I don't fuck it up, like the whole time. So you kind of like allow the director to have their style. And I think I've become more malleable because I'm like, all right, this is what they want and I know how to give it to them.
Right.
But if there's really something that I'm upset about or don't really understand as an actor, I'll go up to them and be like, hey, I don't want to, you know, step on your toes. Just curious as to why we're doing this. And And rarely do I do that because I want to maintain my job. But I kind of understand the process way more now, and how brutal it is, and that an actor is, it's the easiest job in the world, especially when you are watching a set, a huge set, where everyone is trying to just make sure it works. Your job is to just say the line correctly and deliver it as well as possible. And the director's job is to make sure that the whole thing comes together beautifully. So that's really, really difficult. So understanding that there's so much to the process has definitely helped me to also relax on set and be like, nobody gives a shit about me. Yeah. That's kind of liberating.
Right.
To be like, I'm going to just have fun and make choices, and if they don't like them, they'll tell me, and if they do, they'll be like, great, and that's it.
And what do you look for in, like, an ideal director? I mean, you know what I mean? Like, just do you want someone kind of directing, like you just said, like someone that'll come up to you and talk to you? Or
personally, I want someone who's going to be super collaborative and tell me what they you know, who this character is, what they really want, and especially in a film. Where, like, TV, it's like, you book the role, you know what you're doing.
Right.
So you kind of have to trust yourself. And I think that we got into this because, we were originally theater people.
Right.
So I would love to be in a process with a filmmaker who has more of a actor, can talk to actors, can connect with actors, can say in this moment, in this line, in this thing, and pacing, and talk about rhythms, and really get into it collaboratively, as opposed to like, you got it. Absolutely. And then you don't really know.
Right. And do you feel, okay, so now you're working on a short, you just finished it?
I just finished it, and thanks, man. Yeah. I wrote it, directed it, and
started it,
which was insane.
You didn't learn your lesson the first time.
Yeah, I was like, let's make this harder.
Well, you did so well.
And shot it all in one day, so really I didn't learn my lesson at all.
Did you have the same approach in directing the showcase as you did this one? Did you do the rehearsal process? Like, there's just stuff you brought from that and from other directors?
We rehearsed pretty heavily because I knew it was going to be a rough and tumble day.
Right.
We rehearsed pretty heavily, but it also took place in a laundromat, so there was a lot of variables that I couldn't really deal with, which was fascinating.
That makes it fun. Yeah, that's actually
interesting. It was crazy. Yeah. We rehearsed, so we were you know, ready to roll. It wasn't like, oh crap, our lines, like, we were off book. I think we cut like twice because we fucked up a line.
Nice.
And we had 8 hours to shoot in a laundromat and call it a day, and I had originally 64 shots. And I was like, that's not going to happen. So I cut that down. And that's another learning process of, like, you're not going to get everything you want, and the finished product might not be exactly what you thought it was going to be. In fact, it's going to be nowhere near what you thought it was going to be at the beginning. And that was an amazing thing to learn, too. Yeah, I definitely learned from the showcase and took it there, and I definitely will have learned from this, and we'll take it further. But acting in front while directing the whole 11-minute short was a huge undertaking that I say I'll never do again, but I'll probably do it again.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. I hope you do, man.
Thanks, man.
So now, where can we find more about the short, you know, what it's called, and everything that you're doing now, and people can follow the cheese?
The short is called Annie and Peter. Okay. I just submitted to a bunch of festivals. Hopefully it'll get into a couple, and if not, I'll be releasing it on Vimeo and on YouTube, and then I'll send you a link, and
hard
hopefully
copies.
We can send it that way. Yeah. Hard copies, yeah. Just be going throughout
DVDs,
the city.
Yeah.
I do a ridiculous comedy podcast with
you guys should definitely check out my episode when I was on there with him.
Yes, it was a great episode.
You can see me on the other side of this.
Yeah, it's called Shooting the Breeze with Chafe and Cheese. You find it on iTunes, you find it on SoundCloud. We have a website called chafeandcheese.com. And follow me on social media at Alcheh on Instagram, and that's pretty much my jam is Instagram.
So, love it, dude. And we'll definitely get you on next time and talk about, like, podcasting and stuff
for
like that.
Sure.
Like,
it's a whole other beast.
Right, exactly. But it's a whole another avenue and venue for actors.
Absolutely.
Like, to
and
showcase
stuff. And more than anything, it's been a great way to, it's an outlet.
Yeah.
When you're like,
spend time with a buddy.
What am I doing?
Yeah.
And then you just creatively get it all out there. Yeah. So,
well, now that I had you on the show, I'm pretty much going to wrap up The Modern Actor. So, guys, I hope you enjoyed all two episodes before this one. I'm done.
That's it.
This is the reason I was here.
Woo! I appreciate that.
Man. I love this. And thanks so much for being here, brother. Thank you.
It's been a privilege.
Thanks, guys. Hi, guys. I hope you found Alex Alcheh's interview fun as much as I did, and definitely enlightening and inspiring for you guys to go out there. If any of you are thinking about becoming a director, directing yourself in your own projects, If you like what you saw in this episode, definitely subscribe to the Modern Actor website and the Modern Actor YouTube channel. Stay tuned for our next episode, and thanks for watching.